These are actually the definition of epitaphs, or some examples of attacks. Now the attacks on services. Since attacks are, if you just we want to remember or we want to understand by name, then it is, the list is very big and it is very difficult to remember. So what I have tried, that according to that definition of its working, or whether it is software or how the, their routine of works, I have tried to divide that. So it is called data attack. That means obviously the, as its name implies, the data capture. So data interception, that means data hijacked. What is data hijacked? In one organization, every organization, whether it is say our academic institute, faculty members as well as students or employees, both have some, all people have some private. I don't want that what say salary I get, I don't want to publish. Students don't want what CGPA or how he has done in the exam. The parents should not know that thing. Okay? So all of us have some level of private education. I don't want that. Then some data interception, and that data is hijacked. Okay. So this is called the data attack. And for that, what type of thing I can do? It can be some software file is there. Okay? Or that memory, not always it is a software. Because I, after all, that or finally that all the data are stored in some memory. So there it is called some cache attack. You know, or memory attack. You know cache memory? Or some memory attack. So it is also in hardware. Whatever I am telling, that's why I have given some implementation or hardware attack, that whatever, that is both software as well as the hardware is there. Now this is data diddling, that data alteration without authorization. So already I mentioned that now onwards we'll be doing that thing without authorization, that data manipulation. Because not always it is possible to get the whole file or the whole database. But someone can manipulate, someone can change, then actually it is a disturbance and it is there. Now data theft is there, almost the similar thing. Now this is called the network. Because when I define, I told that our main, whenever the cyberspace or we have defined, the one of the important thing is our network. And that we are telling our internet, because now it is that only one network is important. So that network attack is the network interface and network service. So disrupting the network temporarily. So that will also cause the disruption in your communication. And network sabotage, that causing permanent damage to a computer network by deleting files or records from storage. So we must know this. Later I will give specific examples and the names we all of you know, that sometimes that they attack the files, and sometimes it is the data files as well as the program files, both. And this is again another important thing, it is called digital forgery. So digital forgery is very important in cryptographic point of view or attacking point of view. It is simple, that to forge. I am giving a very simple example. See, we have some Xerox machine or some printer. Then what we can do with a simple Xerox machine, easily I can by twice or thrice taking a three copies, what I can do, the records given, name, etc., and the picture of that person, that we can easily change. I'm giving a simple type of that is forgery. So that means instead of the actual or authorized people, authorized data, I am trying to forge a different person. This is or different data. So this is called the digital forgery. It is very, very important. And I'm giving very simple example, but using this concept only, this is not so simple whenever it is, when it is used to attack something. So, but concept is that. Concept is that instead of the actual, the on devices are software attacks, because I mentioned that attacks on devices can be of software attacks or the implementation. I gave the date because I think most of us, May, June, this month, May, I think 12th June or something, ransomware. I think some of you must have heard the name.
Yes,
so that's why I gave, because this is the examples that we faced recently, the problem. So I want to share that. So this is actually the software attacks and the how actually it works. How it works that then the hardware implemented hardware attacks or the implementations, it is the attacks on devices. So there are many implementation attacks. There are many implementation attacks. Why I'm telling implementation? Because finally the devices we are using for communicating something. That can be any electronic devices. Not only every time computer, that your ID card, nothing, smart card, or your ATM card. Okay. So these are also devices, because everywhere some small processor is there, hardware is there. So that that can be attacked. So this is power or electromagnetic radiation attacks. I will give timing attacks of power processor, and then different type of implementation attacks can happen. So these are some of the. So that's why this is that even it is a device. Device is a hardware, but even there also I can put or some attacker can do some software attacks. And this is one of the examples. See, all of us we now are very familiar the term. That's why I gave the term. But there are variety of this or number of variants of ransom. And names are only different. Very simple way. I try to keep that. So it is a malicious software. Block access unless a ransom is paid. First thing, it is a software. The software is nothing but a program. Can be large, can be small. And what it does, the function is it blocks some access. Say it is some our every machine we have some operating system. So all of you know it worked on the Windows operating system. And some Windows 97, I think up to Windows 97, Windows XP didn't work. Up to 97. So this is the operating system, and there that some software in that OS part that they blocked that. And so that the software that operating system doesn't work, and then it blocks the access, and then it is giving some warning or hoax also you can tell that it will, unless a ransom is paid, that it will not work. So what is the technology that how actually it is being done? So it encrypts the victim's files. That means only part of the software they encrypt. You know all of what is meant by encryption? Some y can do fx. So if it is x, some function we apply, it becomes y. Some more things are there, just the timing I'll be telling you. Some timing I just think that x is changed to 2. So it encrypts the victim's file, making them inaccessible, and demands a ransom payment to decrypt them. So this is the thing. This is one of the. So the current ransom that we face, that we heard the things that almost 100 computers, it is in our country also in some port, it is actually the attack was mounted. So it just what it does, using something, whenever it encrypts, actually they use some key. It is some security there. So some using this key, they have encrypted. Since the whose computer it is, I don't know the key, so I cannot decrypt that. And now I cannot use that. So if it is encrypted, fine. So instead of X, now it becomes Y. So it will not work. This is simple. This simple thing. So ransomware warning system course. So always we tell that prevention is better than correction. So that is the concept we have done. So once it is encrypted, if I don't know the key, it is very difficult because there are thousands of different algorithms. I don't know that which algorithm using what algorithm, using which key they have encrypted. So if I don't know the algorithm, if I don't know the key, how I can decrypt the original file? So instead of that, they always try that this is something to defend or how to prevent that thing. So opens an infected email attachment. So always we should, these are the probable sources. So we must check this thing that opens an infected email attachment, clicks on an infected link. Many of us, I think, we have faced, particularly whenever we download something from internet and we face this problem. Installs an infected app from a third-party app store. Visits the legitimate website that has been infected. So we should, if we can try this. This is the prevention of the thing. So how to defend from this? Another thing, I just give an example of ransomware. This is one name only. There are variety of this type of things are these using some encryption, and not always they do encryption, because instead of encryption, what they can do, they can just corrupt some of the files, as I already mentioned in that. So there is also some which I call, these are actually software. So some of our operating system, because that is the main thing, so that in our operating system, part of the program is can be disturbed, then actually it will not work. But particularly ransom, actually they use the encryption. So so how to defend the PC from the use of security software to protect and detect use of antivirus. I gave one, you probably know that thing. Keeping the system watch are always switched on, again prevention. Running manually a full scan of the PC, delete the infection file, ransomware, if detected, and reboot the PC. Not always the last item, it is not possible. Probably many of us will know that thing. Even if it is detected, and even sometimes you have, many times it is required to format the whole thing. Because even we delete the file, why? That time that actually what earlier I told the worms type of thing. In the meantime, actually they have copied. And they have disturbed or attacked many other files. Yeah. So that's why to delete a particular file or some data file, it is not always that is a prevention. So more or less, this should be the our prevention techniques. Okay, these are again some latest updates of Windows, particularly ransomware, because already the latest versions of Windows, you know that XP. Ransomware didn't work. It is only Windows 97. And many of Microsoft's updates fix specific security issues, update all the applications that run frequently. And that's why Android phones are so popular. Every time they're updating. So this is one of the reasons that always that people are trying to, that means always the countermeasures are also a prevention. That procedure that is also going on parallel. So that we try to update that thing. And that is true for, again, for not only operating system, but all other programs also. So not only the operating system, but other programs running on the PC needs to be kept up to date. Though ransomware is only for target was operating system, but I already mentioned there are a variety of things. I gave only one example. There are many other application programs are there, and some other application programs can be the target. But overall, this is the so one is that thing. Later, I'll be telling that encryption normally we use to secure the communication. Here, that is used for attacking. Remember the point. Okay. So normally, the cryptography, that one of the crypto primitives, the most important one and the basic is the encryption that we use to secure our communication. And here, particularly this attack, this and we know, don't know the algorithm also, so that it should not work. So everything is collapsed. Now I go to the other part, devices. Actually, we are doing the devices, and this is hardware, or implementation. Many times we call implementation. And this is very important, because whatever algorithm we need, and finally that we use some, like just now we did the Indian summer, so it is the attack, but they have used some analog. So, most cryptographic algorithms are theoretically or computationally secure. Because whenever it is proposed, all the security measures, etc., that has been done, that's why it has become the standard. It is told that it is a cryptographic algorithm. Because the security is checked. But when it is implemented, that means when one encryption algorithm I am using for my mobile phone, cell phone, that time it is working. It is one algorithm, it is working, which is theoretically secure. But when it is working, that time it leaks some information. And exploiting those information, that it can be attacked. Okay? So this is called the implementation attack. And normally, the term is called the side channel. Side channel means that algorithm is theoretically secure, okay. But whenever it is executing or it is performing, that time it leaks some of the information. It is leaking as if we are taking the side channels and we are trying to exploit that thing. And it is inherent to the physical implementation of the primitive, like light, sound, power, and it is very strong and difficult to predict. And this is called the SCA, the side channel attack, and it exploits such vulnerabilities and implementation. This is implementation-based attack. Because the way, that's why the first slide I defined the, the cyberspace. Because cyberspace is not only our internet, but with the devices coming to over the net. So devices are there. Because finally I am using the net because I want some services. So these are the devices, and that devices, and devices means not only the hardware, because softwares are also there, just to build that thing. That's why software attack once I told. And when it is implemented, that means one algorithm, cryptographic algorithm, which is secure, theoretically secure. But when it is implemented, that is not. Now all of our ID cards are smart card, or ATM card, or any type of card, that is actually the smart card. Which is, what is there? Very small processor, hardware is memory based. Normally, all smart cards are memory based. So, some very small processor with memory, etc. It doesn't have any current source, but normally the reader has the current, etc. Normally, it is passive, but whenever we swap, we make it work, that can improve. Then, immediately, if some algorithms are here, cryptographic algorithms, that means I want to secure. So this is some keys there, some plain text, and some. This is actually some cryptographic devices we are taking, which is mathematically robust. That means theoretically secure. The algorithm that we are using is theoretically secure. So again, I am trying to encrypt what I told while earlier. That means I want to change. Send this plain text. This is my security parameter. This is the most important thing. Using this security parameter key, it is called key, and then it is becoming my cipher text. Now, so this is the current decimal. That means when it is a passive, it doesn't have any current source or voltage source. Pure card when you are looking. But whenever the reader I give, actually it is. So whenever it executes, that time that it whenever it executes, it consumes some power. So if it is a chips, time it is executing, it is the chip becoming hot. Mm-hmm. So some temperature is there or Hammer effect. Then it radiates some electromagnetic radiation that is there. The execution is going on, it has some timing also we can think, and that we can actually catch that. So what I'm telling this side channel, that means whenever one piece of hardware that it is executing, it is actually leaking some of the information. What is that? That some power consumption, what is power consumption it is taking, or that electromagnetic radiation, even that time. And if we can properly catch those informations leaking, this is called the leaking informations, then we exploiting those informations, actually we can try to, and this is a very strong effect. It is very even the theoretically it is not possible. Those algorithms nowadays which are standard, which are not broken or not possible, most of the algorithms are actually broken by this implementation. Discussing about that, how the side channel works. So whenever that one algorithm it is being executed, even the algorithm it is secured if it is a cryptographic algorithm, but when it is executed, then some physical parameters, that is actually it is leaking some information like light, sound, then electromagnetic radiation, power, particularly power consumption. And later we'll see some force, etc., that are actually applied, that we force to get something using this force that I'll be telling you later. So exploiting those information, that leaking information, whether we can break that thing. So these are some types of side channel attacks, and these are power attacks, again radiation monitoring attacks, electromagnetic radiation, acoustic attacks, that means only that timing if we can measure, and then scan chain based attacks. Scan chain I'll be telling that thing, because whenever we use some hardware or any circuits, the testing is one important thing. So there are already some universal test strategies, and whenever some hardware or some chip is built. Now, it is actually contradictory that testing equipment, which is important, which is necessary, that already last 30 years or 40 years it is being used. Now it is shown that is easily that can be used as the attacking equipment. That means what is necessary for testing a chip that is used for, that can be easily exploited to attack that hardware. And then another thing is that fault. So this is normally called not directly this is a side channel, but actually we are forcing to make it or to leak something from the when it is being executed. What is that? So we just put a fault, we mount a fault. What is the fault? Nothing. Because in digital scenario, the message, any message, whether it is data file, program file, I can treat that thing as a strings of zeros and ones. So if some of the zeros we can change, or if one zero we can change to one, then that is treated as a fault. So by some outside monitoring, that if we can change one zero to one or one to zero, that I am telling as a fault. So that's why normally sometimes we call this is something called the applied side channel, not as a direct, because unless I force something from outside, that it will not leak something. So underlying idea is information linked by these side channels can give useful information about the secret. Okay. And in today's scenario, the last one is very fruitful attack. It's a very fruitful attack. Almost all other attacks are slightly older, And FPGAs we use in our laboratories or particularly in our academic environment. This is being used, and then we can so smart cards, because all the cards that we use, just I'm telling so that it will be easier to understand, that small processor, the very resource is very less, and with ROM with memory, some memory based, and there are 8 ways connecting the process. But main thing is that SCs have no internal batteries. This is the passive thing, and the current provided by the reader. This is very important. That means whenever the card is there, now if we have kept, unless it is in the reader, it is being processed, there is no way to leak the thing. But when it is being swapped, that time actually it is being swapped. So measure the circuit's processing time and current consumption to infer what is going on inside it. That is the method here, that when it is being executed. See, this is one very old, but it was successful. In our IIT Kharagpur, this setup we have done long back, I think 10 years before or at that time. This is one very digital oscilloscope, but very sensitive, or I think very costly it was. Since it actually the power consumption that it has detected. And here, say this is one FPGA board, but here instead of this thing nowadays, you can use that any of your card, the smart card thing here you can do. And then we have, with this setup actually, we have broken some standard algorithms which are theoretically secure, that when it is processed, that it can be broken. Okay. It is there in the native search, currently it is published, so paper is there, you can do some project here. And how it works? So simple power analysis, you give the data input, data output, and the power supply. And then the power consumption that we with the oscilloscope, that the power consumption we probe that power consumption. And I'm just showing, it is not that type of thing. Actually, it's a statistical thing. So model is statistical. So millions of, or even at least 1,000. So they are actually improvements are there with how much less power probing you can attack that thing. So later, there are many algorithms or many schemes are there with very less numbers, say 10,000, 20,000, that type of power probes, even it can be broken. Better I come to the... Again, that simple power attack, like differential power attack. So mainly this is the procedure, just algorithm wise, that many power consumption curves, and then assume a key value, because finally I want, attack means I want the key, that which key is used to encrypt, divide data into two groups, this is actually a model, and calculate mean value curve of each group, correct the key assumption, not negligible difference. Then we'll be getting this type of, for a correct value, I'll be getting this type of peak, correct key value. So DPA waveform with the highest peak will validate the hypothesis. So it is a model. So, and see that average power consumption, if I just draw that thing, and then power consumption differential curve with correct key guess. If it is a correct key guess, then the model is such that I'll be getting peak. If the incorrect key guess, then I'm getting a random. Okay. So this is another thing, that whenever we use the attack or prevention, if it is random, then actually I cannot differentiate with that thing. So this is one very important thing for that random. Now the electromagnetic power analysis. See, here, though we have done this power attack, but there is one, what I should tell, that is not practical. For research purpose, it is fine, because for the thing is power attack, you have to get the access of the card. That if I want your some smart card, your ID card to be attacked, then I must, at least for some times, I have to get your ID card, which is sometimes very difficult. So this
electromagnetic radiation, there is no requirement of getting that card. I'm giving example, actually practical data. All other analysis and models is are same as that of the power data. But here, that when it will be executing that algorithm, that it will actually there will be some radiation. And if that you can capture, and there are very good equipments are there that we can capture those radiation. See, in this way, normally I'm giving one example actually, while these cards are broken. So it is happened in some petrol pump. Normally, that people uses go to the same petrol pump. Okay, and whenever they solve the card, and if some radiation that probe that is there, and with 1 month's data, say if 1 month or even 6 months, one people go there, that one particular people who is the target, then you can collect the data, and in that way actually, and then the analysis has been done for the analysis, the model that I have shown just now, that using that thing, that card, the smart card is broken. Okay, so only one thing here it is required, but you remember normally the petrol pump or some mall where people go in the same place. So it is required to get the data because it requires a lot of, it's a statistical model. That's why we want a lot of data. But there are many such type of thing, places are there where people normally likes to go the one same place. So that if that type of power robot or that electromagnetic to catch the electromagnetic radiation, that type of equipments are there, then easily that can be broken. Already this thing happened. Okay. So that's why it is very practical. Now timing is that running time of a cryptographic algorithm can be used as an information channel, but not very for one particular site or one particular device, because we have started our discussion with device attacks on devices. It is not true, but over internet for cyber attack, this is very important, because always we can write some program that will measure the time. You know that you means that type of comments are there, and if you can write a small program that will actually your compute the times, and then we can analyzing those times, we can do the attack. So this is also a very simple tool. Now, what I was telling to you that fault injection, that currently this is the most threatening, and one thing is that it is software as well as that in hardware, everywhere it is actually possible. So already the concept I told that transient or the provisional and permanent, that destructive force. That means whenever mainly fault means already I mentioned that 0 becomes 1 or 1 becomes 0. So whenever it is being communicated, it is finally strings of zeros and ones. So by making, even by using softwares, I can change the 0 and 1. And if it is a hardware, obviously I can do by lasers or some other ways also. Because whenever we do in the academics, normally this laser light, etc., that equipments are very costly. In our place, it is not there. In IIT Kharagpur, now we have one in our lab, but it is very costly equipments. But even we don't require that thing. Easily we can inject fault. So variations to supply voltage. So that supply voltage that we use, just if we can change, and it will be a, if you can easily, you can change that thing. And second one is more powerful, external clock. Because remember, whenever we use a chip, it has some set clock. Remember, whenever we use some chip, we tell that this, it works in 250 megahertz. So instead of 250 megahertz, if I apply 260 or 230, then it is an unset clock. And then it will actually, it will not work properly. And that we can model as if it is same as that of if I change some of the bits. So easily we can do that thing. We have done that part. This is also we have done. It got very good results. It is available in the publication. paper in net. So we can do many other algorithms, because only one algorithm we have shown, there are all cryptographic algorithms are there, and that we can do this thing here. Now similarly, temperature, white light, laser light as I mentioned, or X-ray and waves, electromagnetic flux, these are already, particularly these 3-4 are very costly, but using these 3-4, you can easily do that. Uses those things for that type of setups. Okay. I am telling, since if you are interested, at least many students are there, some of you can easily do that thing. The principle I told, the fault attacks are most efficient, and faults are injected during cipher operations. Easily we can do that part. The attacker then analyzes the fault-free and faulty cipher text or key streams to deduce partial or full value of the secret. Okay, a simple way I tell that normally that when it works, that when it is fault-free, that it is nothing but my ciphertext. For each bit, I can represent an equation. This is nothing but a set of equations, which cannot be solved. If it is solved, then it is broken. Because variables are key and plain texts, and these are ciphertexts. Okay? If it is a 128-bit, I have 128 number of equations I can check, where the number of variables are 256, 128 keys and 128 plain text. Okay. Now, if we study some algorithm in such a way that if I change some values, then I get the set of output equations in such that easily I can solve. This is the principle. So that study we have to do. You have to select algorithm, and you have to study that where I can change and how many changes are required, whether 10, if 10 is changed to 1, or 50s are changed to 51s, so that my output equations, set of equations becomes solvable. This is the research that we have to do, and it is quite possible. Number of standard algorithms which are theoretically secure that are actually broken by this. So this is very successful attack and very threatening. Okay, this is another thing what I was telling. This can change. Normally this is universal standard. Universal standard that to test one chip, I need this can change. That means there are inputs we put, scanning we got, and output. This is standard. Last 50 years we are using that thing. Now, from this attacking point of view, from cryptographic point of view, this becomes a threat, because using this scanning, now we can put some extra information, and we can, with the scan out, I can get the internal information, right? Because here, that string cipher, say, any cipher or whatever, I need a memory. And what is memory? Memory is nothing but a set of shift registers, memory element, deep flip-flops like that. So, here what we can do, that these deep flip-flops, that what is the content of that thing that I can get from this scan-out thing. I can get this, that is, it is given. This is also very strong, but now there is some prevention has been made, and I will take this as the countermeasure. Okay. So, these are some of the things that we can use. These are the attacks normally used for devices. So, countermeasures are normally confidentiality, that means encryption, that is used. But today we have seen that in ransomware, encryption is used to attack. Okay. Then authentication, that means whether someone, again this is prevention is better than correction. That means that before something happens, before the attack happens, if I authenticate, that means whether someone is an authorized user or authorized receiver or not, then we can do. This is called a authentication. Normally authentication is of two types. It is called that entity authentication and message authentication. So every day we use that entity authentication. That whenever I give my login, username and login and password, that is nothing but I am authorizing myself. This is entity. And something we call that some Then access control, already we mentioned when we have discussed that software part for virus, worms, etc. That if we can check on the access control that where the accesses are given, and if we see that some unauthorized or control is given to someone else's while it is not given, then we can do that thing. Then cyber forensics. So this is again nowadays is very important, is that discovery, analysis, and reconstruction of evidence. Reconstruction of evidence that is already broken or is the target. Not always it is possible to, but it is the target. That means whether someone is trying to probe. So from the evidence, some analysis is being done. And this is device protection using password, as already I mentioned. This is the indicator. So these are some of the very common things. Okay. Now this confidentiality, these are the technology we use that we So encryption, we already have done that if two party communicates, and then it will be encrypted. That means it is changed to plain text, is changed to ciphertext with that of a key. And here we do that. So this is one of the fundamental things. Almost all countermeasures it is being used. Okay. So that using this key, the plain text becomes. And here the previously this was algebraic attacks, statistical attacks are there, but now it is the side channel attacks and whatever attacks today I mentioned that is there. Now this is one of the most popular countermeasure against implementation attack is masking, and that is a random masking concept. In one sentence, we can tell that something is secure if I cannot differentiate the output from a random number. Then, that means the attack means I can predict that thing. So, if it is a random number, I cannot predict that. So, this is, and mathematically, we can do that. This is we know that many mathematical functions we can do. So, randomly generated mask was used for each of these encryptions. Okay, this is remote authentication. And I think whatever I was telling, that not everything bad. So, because attacks and cyberspace, we have to use the internet, but only one internet and not at all secure. That's why so many attacks are possible. Now, this is first thing we should, that's why we wrote career opportunities, because it is of tremendous use, or we have to develop our technology as well as the our capabilities to prevent the attacks. That's the cyber security. And one thing I should tell, that first thing is the research, that IT research you can take, or cryptography, or even attacks, so that this is one of the things. I wrote career opportunities because all the fields that it is required, and almost nothing is there. Very few. That attacks are there, so many. And one designer, if someone is a good designer, he or she must be a good attacker, because her algorithms or the device that must be tested with the attacks. So these things are, I should tell that, and this is different area where our expertise should be developed. Okay. So information security, IT security, security system administration, that is very much required, because operating system ransomware is nothing but that. Most of the cyber attacks are attack the operating system. So system administration, I gave the example of malware, or the even network research is there. Then defense tool developer, simply the software doing forensics, computer analyst, because finally I told that analyze the model or getting the evidence from the infrastructure. And forensic computer analyst, information security analyst, penetration tester, security analyst. Actually, I can, in increase and increase. So these are almost open, all the things are open, and that's why you took this opportunity. This is the goodness or the some positive thing in this area. That we have to, because negatives are already there and always it will be there. So to prevent that thing, or countermeasures, or to defend this attacks, we have to develop this. Okay, there are some projects I just mentioned. I took from the internet that what are in India particularly, that what type of projects are going on. So if some of you are interested, then we can do that. So with this, I finish.
Thank you, Professor.
Confidentiality and the
to welcome Dr. P. S. Ram, Director of Technology and Strategic Innovation. And that is the director. And it truly is a pleasure to welcome our very own Sriram, who was with us a faculty in Department of Physical Sciences from 2007 to 2012. And Dr. Sriram has this uncanny, you know, ability, you know, which what impressed me most is that, you know, to somehow see the things as they are. For example, I remember, I also came here in 2007. You know this AFM, what was that? Atomic Force Microscopy. So when I, you know, he's a theoretician. He did his PhD from Institute of Physics, Bhubaneswar, Condensed Matter Physics, with Professor S.J. Mishra. So first time when I met him, he was telling me about, you know, this Professor Arup Rai Chowdhury, you know, doing experiments with atomic force microscopy, and what he's suspecting, that there are these water bonds, they may be responsible for what they are seeing. And Professor Rai Chowdhury's student used to come here, and they finally really explained that this water bonding is the one which is responsible for this kind of effect, what they were seeing. Really down to what kind of level. Then we had those days quite good interaction because we are all in Salt Lake, IIT Kanpur Extension Center. The next round of discussion was about path integral. And then also he with Vasis did some remarkable work. And many more. Then of course, during all those years, Sriram had his heart in computers. So, and finally he moved and he's went to this company. Now he is the director of that company. I'm pretty sure many of you would like to do projects with him because he is a hardcore condensed matter physicist, very, very good idea about quantum mechanics, how it really works at the downwards level, and yet having a fabulous insight about the working of computers, which we don't have. You ask me, I cannot touch a computer. So I request Dr. Sriram to deliver his talk. Note one thing, he has a 5-year each. So 2002 to 2007, he was in SNBOS, 2007 to 12 here, and 12 to 17, let's see somewhere if he's moving.
No, there's no transfer.
No.
Now I'm stuck. Good afternoon, everyone. Prashant, thank you for such a long and, you know, pretty embarrassing introduction. yes, we've had a lot of interactions, so I guess Prashant knows me as down to earth as he said. I know a lot of physics, but I'm off that for a long time now. So one of the unique things about what I'm going to talk about today is the fact that this is going to be the only talk which is given by a complete non-academic person. Currently non-academic person. So sit back, enjoy, think of this as an advertisement before next movie starts. Okay. So before I start this talk, I would like to ask a few questions. How many of you have cell phones? Please raise your hand. And how many of you have smartphones? Okay, bad question. How many of you don't have smartphones? Good. I expected that. So all of you almost have smartphones, right? So when Anirban first contacted me and he said, talk about cybersecurity, of which I am definitely not an expert. I have worked with cybersecurity for a long time in multiple ways, but I would never consider myself an expert in cybersecurity. It's a long, damning, and very, very difficult subject. And I always was very down to earth, so I would never take touch of any difficult subjects. Okay? So, what I'm going to present to you is a very simple story. Okay? Sit back and enjoy the story. Luckily for me, my talk is after one talk after lunch, so you won't sleep, hopefully. Okay? So, if I start thinking about, if I now have a quiz right now, I'm damn sure that all of you will be able to answer the questions on what is this? Oops, sorry. Yeah, now I'm back. Okay, so basically one of the means of protecting over the internet, which is basically using encryption, of which you have been hearing since morning and you'll be hearing in the evening also, I guess, right? Great. So this is one of those things. The second is what we basically call the access control. The access control can be in multiple ways. It could be basically using ID passwords or smart cards or any kind of fingerprints and fingerprinting and so on. So it's basically everything that comes into picture. And then in today's day, people are also using what is basically called artificial intelligence in order to fight cyber crime. Okay? So essentially one of the ways in which it is used is to understand behavioral patterns. So by using behavioral patterns, data which is collected, a lot of data which is collected in terms of behavioral patterns, one can actually kind of predict the possibility of a crime being committed and so on. And then there is a technology called big data, which is something that we are more involved in. So anybody who wants to know about it, outside, not here. I can give a 1, 2, or 3 hour lecture on it. Okay? So this is basically a technology which has come today, which is basically like artificial intelligence, is business intelligence. Okay? It's ability to gather sensible information out of a humongous amount of data. Earlier that was not something that was even thinkable. Today it can actually happen. To give you a context of what it means, any telecom company in India today is supposed to retain every single data transaction which is done through a mobile phone or through a data card for a period of 7 years. Okay? So 7 years of data, of every single data transaction which is done. Data transaction basically means you sit on your mobile right now, you're not interested in this talk, just go and check your website. Check a website, right? That information is not coming to me, but it's definitely going to your mobile data provider, and they have to store it. And what do I do with just storing the data, right? And this is, if you, to give you the kind of context, how big that data is, how really big that data is. The average number of such connections which come per second goes into a few tens of thousands, right? So per second, we are not talking about per day, per minute or anything, it's per second, okay? In fact, a few lakhs. So think about every second's data going into the servers, right? Now, what do I do with that data? I can store the data. The government has said you have to store the data. And why does the government say you have to store the data? This data can be used to trace some cyber crime which has happened at an earlier time. So this is not preventive data, but this is not preventive measures, but this is more like an investigation. Now, if I have to pick up a particular digital transaction which has happened at an earlier time, and I don't know the time, by the way. I don't know the time. All I know is a few small clues that I have, and I have to go through a hell of a lot of data to just find that one single thing, okay? One single data, information. Now, there is no zero business intelligence software which can do this stuff at this data level, okay? So, big data comes in this place. When I say it cannot do it, what I basically mean is it's like cracking a algorithm, that quantum algorithm.